Okay, thank you. Am I loud enough? It will be clear within a second what I mean by stretching the meaning of organic photovoltaics. Because behind this title is a different title, and it's called Efficient Broadband Conversion of Near Infrared Light. So, and that is with organic stuff. And so that's why I say I stretch the meaning of OPV. Okay, and this is something that we did recently, and we came online just a week ago. This is work that has been done by a PhD student, Meng-Chan Zhu, and two people who did a little bit of synthesis, and Maxim Pshenichnikov, who guided most of the photophysics. This is a third generation PV kind of talk. And I hope by now I understand that there has been already some lecturing about third generation principles, so I don't have to go too much in details. And I didn't know that before lunch, so I still have my slides in. You know that there are several tricks that people are working on. Tandem cells you have heard about, I understand. Another way is to separate the light into different concentrators, very, very cute principle that has been studied by some groups. And in each individual concentrator, you have a suitable band gap solar cell on the side. Another thing is a famous principle only, is the intermediate band gap principle. The problem with that principle, it's a beautiful principle, of some kind of a material that has an extra band in the middle, and which is like half filled, and that you can populate or depopulate according to your photovoltaic wishes. The only little problem with this concept is that it's only a principle, and nobody knows how this material in reality would look. If they simply don't exist. But if you would have that, you could have a maximum efficiency of something like 63%. Then we have the hot carrier solar cells. I don't know if will they be treated in this summer school? No, not at all. Well, then I can just only simply, keep it very simple. What is a hot carrier solar cell? It means that you try to get your charges out before they thermalize. So if you have a strong photon, a high energy photon, you excite high, you get a high energy electron, and you try to get it with that excess energy out. So you have to have very funny, energetically specific context to harvest that extra energy. Very difficult to do. Then there's impact ionization, which has something to do with the Auger process. It's the inversion of the Auger recombination. So if you have one big excitation, that excitation can, let's say, reorganize into two smaller excitations in the same material. So you get two electron hole pairs from one photon. Of course, then the photon energy has to be more than twice the back, at least, right? And then we have up and down conversion, and I understand that you have heard already a little bit about it, and I'm not going to go on down conversion. I'm going to go and talk about up conversion. So up conversion, simple, adding two photons and hopefully get a new photon out with the sum of the energies. This kind of up converter that you would have in the solar cell like that, you can put it behind the solar cell, and then the low energy radiation goes through that cell, is up converted, comes back with a mirror, for example, comes back and is then absorbed and converted to electricity. And down conversion, if you do that, then you have to put it in front of your solar cell to first cut the high energy photons into two lower energy ones that are suitable for your band gap. Okay, so much for the general introduction on third generation. And now I will not talk about solar cells anymore. Not at all. I'm just going to talk about how to increase the possibilities with up conversion. Okay, so you know that we lose most of the IR light in the most common solar cells, and that you therefore lose about 50% of all the energy because it's in the infrared. So the standard thing is we'll come back. I'll come back to that in an hour when I have another talk about the Shockley-Weiser limit a little bit. You know that the fundamental losses in a single band-gap photocell are very simple. Your high energy photon, the excess energy is lost in terms of heat, and if you have low energy photons, they're simply not absorbed. And that gives you, that brings you very fast, let's say, to the losses, the fundamental, those are the two fundamental losses that bring you to a maximum efficiency of the thing. So, if you are able to do a conversion, if you would, in the ideal world, and everything would work with 100% efficiency internally, the maximum efficiency for such a solar cell would be 51%. In that case, you you have to add two photons. All the IR photons have to be added. And here I draw something with equal, the energy here is the same as the energy there. Theoretically, you want to do that not, you don't want to do that symmetrically, so you cover a little bit more on the IR and so on. But that's, those are details. So what are the traditional, what are the good up-converting materials? The best up-converting materials are lanthanide, trivalent lanthanide doped inorganic materials. They have erbium, ytterbium, yttrium, those kind of rare earth centers in there, and they do the job. I'll talk a little bit about it. And the problem is, so one of the best materials that you can make is this compound. It is sodium fluoroitrate that has been doped with ytterbium and erbium. And if you you can make nanoparticles of those, and we work with the nanoparticles. Although I must admit that the nanoparticles of the same materials have a slightly lower upconversion efficiency than the bulk materials. But you will see that we need to work with the nanomaterials. So we work with nanocrystals of these materials, and they have organic ligands to stabilize them and to make them soluble. That's the oleoamine groups. Long alkyl chain with an amino group that sticks to it. And if you make a solution of this stuff, all the work I'm talking about is going to be in solution, in chloroform. We did everything in chloroform. This whole story is in chloroform. Nothing to do with the solar cell. And if you look at the absorption spectrum of these monsters in chloroform, at an incredible concentration, this is more than half a gram per mil, then why do I need that? Because I want to see the absorption. I don't want to see this. This is just scattering. That doesn't count. But this is the real absorption of those nanoparticles. And now you see that that although people work with these materials, that's obviously an incredible problem. If you think in terms of a solar cell, and you, even if those monsters would do it with 100% efficiency, you would hardly see the effect. Because they only will harvest those few photons that are in this range, and they have an extinction coefficient of nothing. Yeah. So although internally they would be at the internal quantum efficiency, if you wish, they could be very good, but you know, or you can see immediately that the external quantum efficiency is bad, and then of course the integrated external quantum efficiency, which really counts, is going to be totally hopeless. And that's why upconversion is a real academic subject. It's that you don't hear too much about it in the serious business. Okay, so how does this work? And so if we take these, and I'm only going to concentrate on this material that has this ytterbium and erbium doped trifluoroitrate. So here are your erbium states, and here's ytterbium. And what happens is ytterbium is excited, the ytterbium centers are excited, and then you can have a second excitation, and then it can populate an excited state of the erbium. So the ytterbiums work, and they can populate either this state, or that state, depending on the energy of the second photon. So you can have the 2H1 11 over 2, and this and that can give you this transition, or you can populate the F4F state, or you can populate the 2H, the 4S, and the 4F. So you get three different transitions. Now, the highest energy is, of course, the bluish emission, and then you have the greenish emission that comes from the 4S state that gives you this peak in the visible, and then you have a little bit of a red emission. So this is the upconversion emission spectrum of that material. Okay? And this is something that we like very much, because if you upconvert to the region 500 and 700, you are nicely within an average solar cell, especially an organic solar cell area. So what has, so as I told you, the efficiency is quite low, or, well, I shouldn't say the efficiency because that sounds like quantum efficiency, right? But the overall upconversion effect is not very high because you have a lousy absorption and you have a lot of problems. So what have people done in order to increase this? Now the first thing is that they look at the host material for these upconversion centers, for the ytterbium and the erbium ions. So if you use the host that I already described to you, that we use, that's 20 times better than a lanthanide oxide host, which is again 4 times better than a lanthanide molybdenate host. So we certainly are not going to those. This is why we focus on this material as a start. This is, let's say, the best nanoparticle kind of material that exists. Then people have investigated whether it helps to have a non-upconverting shell around it to protect it a little bit from quenching from outside or surface effects. And indeed that helps. You can, if you have a coarse shell, you can have 30 times better effect if you do it with undoped tetrafluoroxide. And there are other shells that have been made around it that give a little bit less improvement. And then there's the work with the surface plasmons. Surface plasmon resonance enhancement of the absorption. As first, the first papers were talking about 2 to 4 times enhancement, but more recently there's this paper that in which they saw 100 times the enhancement of the absorption. But of in that same absorption range, in the same wavelength range. So that still is not a very good idea. So what do we want? What we want is, we want upconversion, let's say, everything above 700 or 800 nanometers, and we would like to harvest all this IR light, and we would like to upconvert all that IR light. That would be, that is what you need for a solar cell. And then if you have an upconverter that does it with this wavelength, maybe you need a second upconverter, which is there, if you know what I mean. Maybe at 1500 or 2000, and you try to do that again with another converter and bring that back into your solar cell as well. Something like that. Okay, so what we do, we focus on these nanoparticles, and here is a picture of the nanoparticles that we have. It's a transmission electron microscope picture, and here I gave you the average distribution, size distribution. So the peak is in the maximum is around 16 nanometers. That's what we have. That's what we meant. We can make it reproducibly on large scale, so it's easier. Okay? So now, how are we going to do this? Well, we got inspiration, if you wish, from the natural light harvesting system. Because if you look at the photosynthesis system, you can see that you have a so-called reaction center, and it's surrounded by all these antenna molecules. And that, and then you have other antenna circles and so on, and they all funnel this energy into your reaction center. And we thought maybe we can do something similar. So we have not a reaction center, but an upconversion center, a UC, not a CU, but a UC. And maybe we should have some kind of an antenna system around our upconversion centers. So that was all. That's the whole thing. That was the whole idea. Okay, so what we want to do is the following. Imagine that, let's say the blue spectrum, it's a stupid spectrum, but let's say the blue spectrum is the absorption spectrum of your photovoltaic cell, of your active layer. And here is the upconverter, you know, 1975, it absorbs in 1975. And in green is the upconverted light, and this is the spectrum that I showed you before. And you see it fits nicely in something like a P3HT kind of absorber. Now, this, now we're going to extend this. What we are going to do, we are going to add an antenna. So we want to have antenna absorption here. And then, of course, the antenna has to emit in one way or another, or transfer the energy into the upconverter. So you know from photophysics, you know, first the energy transfer kind of stuff, that you need an overlap between the emission of the antenna and the absorption of your acceptor. Energy acceptor in this case. So we want something like that. And then of course we want to have that all this energy is upconverted here and is going back into that. Okay. So we need to have antenna lights. Now this was a little bit more problematic, and this took us more than a year before we had the answer. Because near IR dyes is not your average dye kind of chemistry and stuff. It's a little bit tricky. But we found these cyanide dyes. The cyanide dyes are famous for being near IR dyes. And this cyanide dye is called IR780 for a very simple reason. Its absorption maximum peaks at 780 nanometers. That's why it's called IR780. This is the spectrum. So it's very important, no absorption where the solar cell absorbs. And then we have our IR region that we're going to try to harvest for upconversion. Okay, but we cannot use this material, although it looks good, but there's a problem. Of course, we have to put this on our nanoparticles, so we have to functionalize it. Chemistry, and so what I tell you here in 5 seconds, that took also more than half a year, because this chemistry is a little bit more tricky than we anticipated. A simple replacement of this chlorine atom by the sulfur, a nucleophilic substitution, as we call that, and you get this product. And indeed, we get it almost 90% now, since we know how to do this. But it took a little while. Once you know how to do something, it's so simple. But sometimes it takes a long time before you know, right? And so this molecule is now, so now you recognize it's the same dye, but now it has this carboxylic group that you probably also know from dyes that go in dye-sensitized solar cells on titanium. It's the same thing. This is dye. Okay, so here's a chemical picture of a space-filling model of the compound. And so this is the antenna part, and this is the antenna part, and this is like the part that should bind to the nanoparticle. So I make a very simple cartoon. This is the antenna, and it has some kind of a... Okay. Well, you know, you do chemistry, so you change your chromophore. You have to realize that this is the chromophore, all those double bonds is your chromophore. So when you replace something here, you know for sure that you're going to change the chromophore a little bit. And indeed we do, but not too much. You see the difference? This is absorption spectrum. In orange is the IR780, and our product has a maximum at 806. So hereby I pronounce our product IR806. Very simple. So our antenna molecule is IR806. And we look at the emission of IR806. The emission is here. It peaks at about 840. And there's a tail. And it's not very good. But at least there is some overlap with the absorption of the nanoparticles. There's a real blow up of the absorption of the nanoparticles. Is this orange spectrum. And you see we have some overlap. It's not much. But, you know, we said, okay, let's try. Maybe it works. Maybe this one is good enough. So it could be much better. I know, I'm sure that we can design and have and find better ones later, but this is what we have as a first example. Okay. And then, one thing you should not forget, that the absorption strength of our antenna compared to the nanoparticles is 390 compared to 6 times 10 to the minus 5. Yeah, talking about difference in absorption. That's more than a million times more stronger absorber. So the next thing, put them on the nanoparticles. So we took our solution of the nanoparticles, just added a solution of our antennas, and you just wait, and what happens, and what you hope, and it does happen, you replace some of those olealamine groups by your carboxylic acid. It's just an exchange reaction. You just wait overnight, and you know, it's done. So it's very simple, room temperature, just wait. And so then you hope that this is the reality, this cartoon. And now we expect that we have the nanoparticles with some antennas, depending on the ratio, of course, that we use. And we also have, of course, some of those other olealamine groups. And if you evaporate everything afterwards, you clean it up, then you can clearly see that you have a good result, because those are the nanoparticles before, and those are the nanoparticles after. Deep, dark green. Why deep, dark green? Because you have that little tail in the red. And you have an infrared absorber, but you have that little tail in the red, and therefore, of course, your material immediately looks green. Okay. So this is now we look at the spectrum of IR806, and we are going to look how much does the spectrum of the antenna change because it's now sitting on the nanoparticle. Because a surface will always influence your molecule properties, and also with the nanoparticles. So we have to make sure that everything is okay. So here's what happens. IR806 pure in chloroform solution has this orange spectrum, but when you have the same amount and you add the nanoparticles, then the absorption peak goes down. There's a little bit more absorption here and a little bit less absorption here. If you look at this peak absorption and you titrate your solution of your dye, your antenna, with nanoparticles, so with increasing nanoparticle concentration, this peak goes down from here to here, and that is this, it goes from normalized from 1 to what, about 70%. Okay? Nothing special. I mean, that I don't think that means very much. What's much more important is, of course, the emission. Because what you would like to see that the emission of your antenna is quenched. Because that means that the emission is not happening, but that the energy is going, maybe in the right way, hopefully, into the nanoparticle. If the emission is not quenched at all, it would never work. So, what you see is you take the dye, okay, you take the antenna, and you add to that solution more and more nanoparticles, and you can see that the emission normalized goes from 1 to about 35%. It's not great. I mean, yesterday I was talking about a factor 1,000 quenching by adding a fluorine to a polymer. That was a factor 1,000. And here it's down to 35%. But at least it does something. And you have to be very careful because the absorption spectrum changes in the meantime, as I just showed you, with increasing the concentration of nanoparticles. So you have to sit and concentrate. And we use 750 to excite, and there the absorption increases. So with increased absorption, it goes down. So it's really, we recalculate. So we have about 35% or 65% quenching. You can also look at the lifetime, of course, of your luminescence. And if you look at the lifetime of the pure of the dye, the antenna, in pure solution in chloroform, it has a lifetime of roughly 1.1 nanosecond. And when the dyes are sitting on the nanoparticles, you have roughly half. So, in one case we find roughly half, in the other case we find something like 30-60% quenching. So, you know, what's the difference? It's almost the same. So, that's consistent. What is important is now, is this quenching because of the nanoparticle itself? That wouldn't help us. The quenching has to be because of energy transfer to the ytterbium sensors. So, how do we know whether it goes to ytterbium or whether it's quenched by the material itself? Very simple. You take nanoparticles without ytterbium. Okay? So we repeat this experiment that I just told you. We repeat it now on non-doped nanocrystals. They are exactly the same size, the synthesis is all the same, but the ytterbium and the erbium is not in there, so they cannot absorb that energy. Okay, what you see is that the absorption spectrum of our dye again goes down. So that decrease in the peak here and increase here is identical what happens with the doped and the non-doped. So that's a real surface kind of a effect. Nothing special here. That was the previous one. This is the one now. I got confused about my own page. Okay, now let's look at the fluorescence. So, you know that I told you that when you put the dye on the doped nanoparticles, your fluorescence goes down to 35%. Here is the difference between free and on the nanoparticle, and you can see it does not quench the emission. So we take that as a good clue that the emission is quenched the way we like it, if the energy goes to the upconversion centers. Okay, now it's time to do the real experiment. I have told you enough other stuff. So let's go to the test. So we excite at 800 nanometers. And I hope you remember that the nanoparticles themselves have absolutely zero absorption at 800 nanometers, because they only have that little absorption at 975. Nothing at 800. Okay. So if we take a solution of pure nanoparticles and we irradiate with 800 nanometer light, it's not surprising that our upconversion spectrum is zero. You don't see anything, right? Obvious. Next one is pure dye. We want to make sure that we do not have some kind of a funny two-photon process that you can have with organic molecules. So we take the pure solution of IR806, and again, we see, although it absorbs, of course, strongly at 800, it's close to the maximum, you see zero upconversion. Now we take the solution of the dye and the nanoparticles together, boom, bingo. So, we call this DUC, because dye-sensitized upconversion. I didn't like D-suck, so I left out S. It sounds stupid, D-suck. So I said, okay, I have to make it. At first I wrote D-suck. DUC. Okay, so it's dye-sensitized upconversion. And this is the spectrum that we see, which looks very familiar, I hope so, for you in the meantime. And you know that you can actually, I mean, I found it exciting. I mean, usually I'm not I don't go to the laser lab to look what they are doing. And they are not my labs anyway. But this time I went, because you know, you can really see the green light. It's really bright green light. It's beautiful. So it works. And oh, yeah. Oh, look at that. It's a 2 milliwatt laser, continuous wave. It's that kind of laser that is $10. You know, the ones that, you know, really cheap, stupid lasers. So of course we have done a lot of stuff with high tech lasers and so on, to look at these things. I will talk about it. But it's important that we see it at relatively low intensity. I have to admit, it's still more than 10 suns. It's probably somewhere, we guess it's somewhere between 10 and 100 suns. We're not, you know, it's difficult to really make sure, but it's in that order. So it's in a reasonable value, because you could do concentrated solar. Yeah, within 10 to 100 suns is doable. Okay. So, yes, this emission is indeed very close to the same to the emission that you find from the nanoparticles that you excite at 975. And so the original upconversion spectrum is very much like the dye-sensitized upconversion. There's some differences, but I wanted to go and make some conclusions, but I was warned not to do this because the intensities are quite different. Look at that, this is the dye-sensitized one. We do a 2 milliwatts, but in order to see something, we need to do 50 milliwatts for the 975. So you have to be very careful to draw conclusions in this spectrum. Okay, control experience. The control experience is, of course, we need to look at IR780, you know, the one without the carboxylic acid, and to make sure that it is really necessary that the antenna is bound to the nanoparticle. We didn't prove that yet. We just have one super. Yeah? So let's see how that works. So we took the one without the carboxylic acid, and we looked at the absorption of the dye in the without or in the presence of the nanoparticles, and you see there's no difference. Remember, at first that peak went down to something like 60%. There's no difference. It doesn't really. Emission completely identical with and without nanoparticles. Upconversion zero. And this was the upconversion with IR806 and the nanoparticles, and this is the upconversion, which is exactly the same circumstances and concentrations IR survey. So here we prove that you have to have your antenna closed. It's not a surprise, but you know, you want to make sure. So the antenna has to sit on the network. So the next thing, what do we want to do? We want to see how many antennas is good per nanoparticle. Because you can imagine that there must be some kind of a maximum. And indeed, here you see, this is the maximum. What you do, you take a solution of the nanoparticles and you add more and more of the antennas. And you see more and more integrated. Here we have the integrated signal of all the upconversion light and the upconverted light, I have to say. And we have a maximum. We find in chloroform with these stuff and so on, we find this maximum. So here is the ratio, the best ratio, number of antennas per nanoparticle. You have to do some gymnastics and some assumptions here and there, but it's safe to say that we are in the order of 50, 60 antennas per nanoparticle. 5 minutes? Okay. So another thing is that we want to make sure, is this upconversion? If this is upconversion, if it is an upconversion of two photons, then you want to see that the intensity dependence of your upconversion is quadratic with the intensity of the incoming light. It should not be linear, it's quadratic. This is the plot, and n is 1.94. I hope that's close enough to 2 for you. Now we get to the final experiment, the most important experiment. What we are going to do, we are going to do some kind of an upconversion quantum efficiency spectrum. It's not an EQE, but it's kind of a UQE, if you wish. We're going to look how this works for the whole IR part that I told you in the beginning that we want to cover. So first, what we do is we do the experiment with the nanoparticles at the same concentration as will be done in the whole experiment at this low intensity, and even at this low intensity, because we have our Maxime has extremely good equipment, we can see the data points for Earth conversion when you shine light between 950 and 1000. That is the original non-dye sensitized Earth conversion of your nanoparticles. Only if you come up with this light, you see some conversion.
Yeah.
That's the original. Now I have to scale this down. This is a very, very low intensity. So I have to scale it down so that you don't see it anymore. Because only then I can show you what we get if we use it with the dye sensitized nanoparticles, and that's this. So when you have dye sensitized nanoparticles, you get upconversion of all the light that starts here. Here we started, we cannot go further. Up to 850 nanometers. And of course, if you look very careful, you can also see that with these dye-sensitized antenna monsters, you have the same upconversion as without the dyes, when you look at that region, because there you don't need the dyes. Yeah? So the upconverters, they really don't mind whether they have antennas or not, they work at the same efficiency. That's basically what we prove here. So, but this, what my point is, what did we achieve? We achieved a broadband near IR upconversion, because we upconvert all this spectrum to visible light. And if you integrate that, and you integrate what you have now compared to what you had before, only that little peak there, then the factor, the difference is that we have 3,300 times more effect. That's not a higher efficiency. The word efficiency is a little bit dangerous because you think in terms of quantum efficiency, but it is, let's say, it's the upconversion effect, then, if you wish. Yeah? So just to not use the wrong words. And, by the way, if you look at this upconversion spectrum as we measured it, the upconversion activity in the spectrum, it shouldn't follow the absorption spectrum of the antenna, or should it follow slightly something different? Anybody has a clue? Who says that it should follow the absorption spectrum of the antenna? Nobody has, because of it. So then I wanted some answer, what else? Nobody? So it's not the antenna, but nobody knows what it is. And we've been talking about the antenna all the time, so you think I have something miraculous in there? Okay. It's a two-photon process.
Therefore, it has to follow the absorption squared. This is the absorption squared of the antenna. That was the answer.
Okay. So, monochromatic quantum yields. The referees pounded on us. They gave us a hard time because they thought we claimed that the efficiency went up. Of course, the efficiency per photon doesn't go up because we only made it more complicated with the antenna. So therefore, the efficiency, monochromatic quantum efficiency, has to go down. You can never go up because you make it more complicated. So we calculated the monochromatic quantum yield of the pure nanoparticles is 0.3%, and when you have all those antennas, then you go down by roughly 50%, which is very nice in it coincides with this energy transfer efficiency that I told you is roughly 50%. So I think everything makes sense here. So the next step, and this I'll wrap it up really fast. The next step is, of course, that I showed you with IR806 that we can cover roughly this part. But of course, what we can do is exactly the same thing in principle as they do nowadays with the dye-sensitized solar cell. That you do not use one dye, but you use two or more dyes. And then you can imagine that if we could have a dye that absorbs here, then we have a dye that absorbs here, then we can cover the whole stuff. But that would be very key. And this is what we are working on. I can only show you a little bit. We have another one, which is called IR813, which is a little bit more extended here. We do the same reaction again. Now we know how to do that. We make what we call IR840. And IR840 has an absorption spectrum, which is indeed slightly different from 806. What happens, of course, if you make the next one, you always have something that goes worse. And in this case, it is the emission. This one is a worse luminescer, if you wish, than AR806. So if you look at the enhancement, that was 3,300 times with IR806. With this new dye, the enhancement is only 1,600 times. So these are the two dyes and the results in one plot. And this is the one that I showed you with the first dye, and this is the conversion action spectrum, if you wish, for the second dye. So in principle, you can see we do it, and I hope you understand what we are doing right now, and I'm not going to talk about it. So I conclude this story that we can do dye coating of lanthanide nanoparticles, and that we have dye-sensitized for conversion of near-infrared light, that we could increase it to above 3,000 times, and that you can extend this with other dyes for further broadening, and that the monochromatic quantum yield went a little bit down, but not too much, with this first example. And, okay, some people and some money, and that's it.
Okay, are there any questions for Chase? Yeah.
I'm just wondering how much of the upconverted light are really absorbed, or are really reabsorbed by that today?
I don't have an active layer. There's no solar cell, right? There was no solar cell in my soul. Not yet. So I don't have an active layer. I have this is all in solution. I'm only looking at your computer. But I know a little bit more. Because before we did these experiments, we put these nanoparticles in the solar cell. Just in the PCBHT, PCBM lab in order to see that. That was a mess. It was horrible. But one thing we could prove, and that is that there was zero light coming out of the blender. And that's a negative result, which you would like to have. But of course, a negative result doesn't count, because it can come from many other things. So my answer is, I hope, and I have a little bit of a clue, that all that outgoing light is reabsorbed by the surrounding PCBHT, and maybe it's even non-radiative. I don't know. That would be really nice, because in principle that would be more efficient probably. But that's, of course, that's when you put these materials in the active layer, which you can do with an organic solar cell. Yeah? But for now, I have no real results. I don't show them with active layers and solar cells.
One more question.
Yeah, I just wondered, what is the
the initial wavelength for this up conversion process for these what's the up conversion emission? I just forgot. You said it was good for P4HT, but I was wondering, can you tune it so that if you have, say, a lower band gap polymer, can you make it so
So this is another question we got for referees, and that is this good for silicon? And of course the answer is no. Because you don't want to convert light that is already absorbed in by silicon. 800 nanometers is useless for silicon. One of the answers I can give is an academic answer. If you really want to go to the best upconversion solar cell, you go back to theory, and the best upconversion solar cell has an active layer with a band gap of 2 eV, and then everything is perfect. This is good for those kind of cells. And 2 eV is close to what P3HT has. And you asked about the upconversion spectrum, and you missed it. It's not this is it. So this picture shows that the upconversion spectrum is the same whether you use without or with antennas. And this is the spectrum between 500 and 700 of these materials.
No, we started a little bit late because we got late for lunch, so let's wait until after Casey's second one and hopefully we catch up.
You can come to me.
Okay. So we've got a 5-minute break, right? So we're going to catch up a little bit.